Mr. President, last week I traced the history of the Roman people from the founding of the capital city of Rome in 753 BC through the 243 years of the monarchy to the fall of the monarchy in 510 when Tarquinius Superbus was expelled, and the founding of the Republic in 509 BC, at which time the two first Roman consuls, Lucius Junius Brutus and Tarquinius Collatinus, were selected. The Roman consul was the supreme civil and military magistrate of Rome under the Republic. There were to be two consuls elected annually, each for a term of 1 year. Each consul could veto the actions of the other consul. The plebeians continued in their struggle to achieve admission to the offices and privileges of the patricians. Because the monopoly of the patricians over the magistrates with imperium deprived the plebeians of a voice in determining public policy and deprived them of the commands in the army. The plebeian soldier shared with patrician soldiers the dangers in war. And equality of political rights could not be forever kept from the plebeians. The custody of the civil and criminal law, the knowledge of the civil and criminal law, of legal procedures, and the enforcement of the laws, all these were the monopoly of the patrician magistrates and priests, who naturally manipulated them to the benefit of their own class. One of the causes for great strife in the later struggle was the fact that the patrician farmers and patricians in general could not find the monies with which to rent public land in order to make ends meet. The indebtedness of the plebeians was caused in the main by their forced absence from the lands, and also by the property tax that was levied on the land. Additionally, as I say, they could not acquire the capital with which to rent public land or buy additional land and make ends meet. And adding to this condition was the severity of the harsh laws of debt, which enabled the creditor to seize the debtor and sell him into slavery. So the first objective of the plebeians was to acquire for themselves an officer who would act as their spokesman and who would defend them against the oppressiveness of the patricians. And they therefore, as I stated last week, retired to the sacred mount, seceded from the city, and threatened to become a city or a state that would be established for themselves. And they won the concession from the patricians of having an officer of their own who could protect them against the dictates of magistrates. And that officer was the tribune. There were to be two tribunes, either of which could veto the actions of the other, or the actions of any magistrate, or the actions of the Senate, or the actions of a private person. The patricians recognized the tribunes as public officials, in a sense, but not as magistrates, in the strict sense of the term, because they were not elected by the whole people. They were elected only by the plebeians. The patricians also recognized the authority of the tribunes to intervene on behalf of any person seeking aid from actions by a magistrate or from actions by a private person. The patricians, or rather the plebeians, were not satisfied with having achieved the tribunes, officers who would protect them. And so, they determined that they would continue to insist upon their admission to the offices and to the privileges of the patricians. Legal status was given to the meetings of the plebeians as long as the meeting was convened by a tribune and presided over by a tribune. But the meetings of the plebeians constitutionally were recognized as not being meetings in which the actions taken would apply to the people as a whole. Because the meetings were summoned by a tribune, and only the plebeians were summoned by the tribune, and as a consequence, their actions did not constitute actions by the whole people. The meeting of the plebeians took place in the forum, and it was not a comitia, but a concilium, because it was made up of only the plebeians who had been summoned. It was called the concilium plebis, a concilium meaning a meeting not of the whole people, but of only a part of the people. The resolutions that were adopted in the concilium plebis, or in the meetings of the plebeians, was called a plebiscite. And it was applied only to the plebeians. It was not recognized as a law that applied to the whole people, because it was not created by a body representative of the whole people. The plebiscite, for the plebiscite to be valid for the whole people, it had to be approved and ratified by the Roman Senate. So now, up to this point, we have seen the development of the following magistracies, following the fall of the monarchy and the establishment of the republic: the consuls, the dictators, the censors, and now there was created an office for a magistracy, aedileship, the aedile. Was a subordinate officer of the plebeians. And he was to act as an assistant to the tribunes in the oversight of the archives, the management of the prison, and the supervision of public buildings. In time, the patricians also elected such an officer. And therefore, there were four aediles. These aediles had care over the streets of Rome, over the water supply, over the market. And especially supervision over weights and measures. They also had the responsibility for the regulation of traffic and for the public games. And in the later Republic, as the wealth of the city grew, and as rivalry, political rivalry, increased, the conduct of the public games became more and more important. It gave an opportunity to the aediles to make themselves popular and gain votes. Therefore, it became a stepping stone politically. The lowest of the regular magistracies was the quaestorship. In the beginning of the Republic, the consuls appointed two quaestors. One quaestor to serve each consul. As time went on, the Romans increased the number of quaestors to four. Two were to serve as the state treasurers. They had control over the aerarium, which was the public treasury, located in the temple of Saturn, below the Capitol. Of course, they were to be supervised, however, by the Senate, which had full control over the aerarium, the state treasury. The other two then would accompany the office of praetor, P-R-A-E-T-O-R. The praetor was one of the higher magistrates. He had the imperium. The imperium meaning the absolute authority to command. The authority to command the armies. The authority to interpret the laws and to execute the laws. To inflict death, and the infliction of the death penalty. He was not allowed to leave Rome more than 10 days at one time. He had the special responsibility of administering justice in the city. And during the absence of the consuls, during the absence of both consuls from the city, if they were in the field with the legions, the praetor had the responsibility of convening the Senate, convening the assembly, responsibility for the defense of Rome. So now we have the consul, the dictator, the censor, the tribune, the aedile, the quaestor, and the praetor. The plebeians would not rest content, however, with the tribunate and the aedileship. And so they continued to press for admission to the other offices. And it was not until 367 BC that the Licinian plebiscite required that of the two consuls elected annually, one had to be a plebeian. But this was a law that was violated by the patricians over the next 25 years. And it was not until 342, under a stricter formulation of the measure, that we begin to see plebeians elected on a regular basis. One annually of the two consuls. Of course, once the plebeians gained admission to the consulship, they could no longer be barred from the other higher magistracies, such as the dictatorship or the censorship. And as it had long been the custom, that ex-consuls and later ex-praetors were to be enrolled in the Senate's membership, the attainment of these higher magistracies meant an ever-increasing representation in the Senate by the plebeians. So we now see the plebeians becoming more and more represented by their own people in the Senate. Now, what about the other assembly or assemblies under the Republic? Was there just to be the Senate? No. The comitia was an assembly of Romans summoned by a magistrate. And the earliest comitia were the assemblies of the curiae. The curia was the smallest division of the Roman people. And in the era of the kings, the monarch could call upon the comitia curiata for advice. This was an assembly of 30 curiae, 10 for each of the Romulian tribes. Originally, there were 3 tribes. Later, urban tribes were established. And then additional rustic tribes were added. The number of tribes finally reached 35 in the year 241 BC. This number was never exceeded. 16 of the rustic tribes bore patrician names. Early, following the fall of the monarchy, the comitia centuriata came to be substituted for the comitia curiata. The comitia centuriata was made up of centuries of soldiers. A century was 100. The old comitia centuriata affirmed the appointment of magistrates, and it witnessed adoptions and the writings of wills. And it also witnessed the installation of priests, on which occasions the Pontifex Maximus would preside over the curiate assembly. The comitia centuriata voted, as did the consilium plebis, voted by tribes, tribe by tribe by tribe. A majority within a tribe determined the vote of the tribe, and a majority of the tribes determined the action of the assembly. The comitia centuriata elected the magistrates with imperium, as well as the censor. They declared war or peace. And they acted as judges in capital cases. In 287 BC, the Licinian plebiscite gave greater authority to the tribal assembly than was accorded to the comitia centuriata. Greater legislative authority. So here now we see, in the age of the kings, the assembly of the curiae, the comitia curiata, and shortly after the fall of the monarchy, the establishment of the assembly of centuries, the comitia centuriata. Now we see the most powerful of all, the tribal assembly, the comitia tributa. In all of these, however, the actions of the assemblies were only valid if the Senate approved those actions. The Senate could exercise a veto over the actions of any of these, of the assemblies. We therefore see that the Senate remained supreme. The making of alliances and treaties, the formulation and the execution of foreign policy, the waging, the actual waging of war, the control of the aerarium, the public treasury, the government of the colonies and the provinces, the management and distribution of public lands, the power over the purse. All these were the exclusive functions of the Senate. And they gave to the Senate enormous power. The Senate also acted as judge in cases involving assassination, treason, conspiracy. The Senate met in Rome or within a mile of the city. It met in a place that was public and consecrated. It was convened by a magistrate with imperium, or later by a tribune. Upon the convening of the Senate, the magistrate made his report or presented the subject for discussion. After this was done, each senator was asked for his opinion. And he was asked for his opinion in the order of rank. The senior patrician was given precedence. He was called the princeps senatus. And as the Senate became to be made up of ex-magistrates in time, the highest of the magistrates in the Senate would be called upon for his opinion. Then the next highest, then the next highest. The censors, the consuls, the praetors, the aediles, and so on. After they had given their opinions, the vote was taken on each of the opinions by division. Senators in favor would go to that wall and be counted. Senators in opposition would go to that wall and be counted. Or there would be other means of division, just as there are several ways of taking a division here in this Senate. There was absolute freedom of speech. In the Roman Senate. Until the time of Augustus, he placed a limit on Senate speeches. But under the old Republic, freedom of speech was assured. The Senate met from dawn until sunset. Senators, by custom, were not allowed to engage in banking or in public contracts, and they could not own a ship with carrying capacity was large enough to engage in foreign commerce. They were confined to other things. They were mainly landlords. They owned huge farms, pieces of land, and they engaged in other pursuits. Senators wore the latest clavis.
L-A-T-U-S. C-L-A-V-U-S.
Which was a broad purple vertical stripe, either stitched onto or woven into the Roman tunic. They also wore the white toga, especially on formal occasions. They wore a special shoe, a red sandal, and was fastened by straps that went around and up the leg. Roman senators were given special seats at religious ceremonies and at the theater and other public entertainments. They were not allowed to leave Italy without permission of the Senate. It reminds us of Rule 5, the standing rules of the U.S. Senate. Senators are supposed to get permission of the Senate if they leave and are not attending the Senate business. How were the senators appointed? Well, in the age of the kings, they were appointed by the king. And when the monarchy fell, in 510 BC, and the Republic was established in 509, and the two first consuls were elected by the Comitia Curiata, the consuls then appointed senators. In those early days, wealth and being a member of a distinguished patrician family. Were the factors that guided the selection of senators. And then the censors later enrolled members into the Senate. And it was the plebiscite of Ovinius, a tribune, that formulated the regulations by which senators were to be enrolled in that body. And following the Ovinian plebiscite, the consuls were expected to abide by the law, which then required in the enrollment of senators that precedence be given to ex-magistrates. And we therefore then saw the ex-consuls and the ex-praetors being enrolled in the Senate. So here was a body of ex-magistrates, men who had served as consuls, praetors, and later in other magistracies, men who had had command of the armies. Consuls commanded the legions. The praetors commanded the legions. So here was an experienced body of generals. And former administrative officials. And consequently, it was the gathering of the wisest, the most experienced men in public life. Now let's take just a moment to talk about the Roman family. The capital stone, the cornerstone of the Roman social structure was the family. The father had complete authority over everyone in the family. And it was there that the sons and daughters were taught discipline and respect for authority. They were taught to reverence and to sacrifice to the gods. They were taught to venerate their ancestors. And this discipline and respect for authority were carried over by the Roman into his public relations. And it aroused in him a sense of responsibility to the interests of the state that was a basic quality of the Roman character. The highest virtue was piety, which meant the dutiful performance of one's responsibilities and of all of one's responsibilities to the gods, to his kinsmen, and to the state. And it was particularly to the state that the Roman was expected to exhibit loyalty and devotion. Family, friends, in one's life were to be sacrificed if necessary for the state. So one cannot doubt the importance of these values in Roman life. Later, generations would look back to the lives of statesmen and generals of this period, period of the early and middle republic, for examples of patriotism worthy of emulation. A sense of duty ran deep . A Roman who was suited and inclined for public service felt that it was his destiny to serve the state. Public office, certainly in public life. It could be in the military, but this was his destiny. And the Romans agreed with the principle that was enthusiastically enunciated and maintained by Cicero, that it was the civic duty of the citizens to serve in public office and in public life. Since public office and public service were never regarded as a profession, no remuneration was given to the magistrates. Senators served without pay. They had seats for life, unless they were guilty of grave misconduct. But there was no remuneration for these high officials. They served for the honor of serving the state. The only remuneration was for journeys or for special celebrations or for military commands and expenses. It was the Roman's duty to serve for his state. Senators believed that service in that body was the highest honor. And that attendance at sessions of the Senate was an integral part of that public service. This high sense of duty emerged from a dialogue between the Emperor Vespasian and the Senator Helvidius Priscus, as written by Epictetus. When the Emperor Vespasian sent word to Helvidius not to attend a meeting of the Senate, Helvidius answered, "It is in your power. Not to allow me to be a member of the Senate." But as long as I am one, I must attend its meetings. Plutarch tells us that the same high sense of duty was demonstrated by Marcus Porcius Cato, the younger, who lived between 95 and 46 BC. There was no meeting of the Senate which he did not attend in order to keep a watchful eye on the partial remissions of fines and duties. And unreasonable grants. When the Senate was summoned, he, Cato, was the first to give attendance and the last to withdraw. He thought that a good citizen ought to be as solicitous about the public as a bee was about his hive. Those were the words of Plutarch. So, Mr. President, we see the discipline, the respect for authority, the high sense of duty, the old Roman virtues that formed the sterling Roman character. We see the development over time of various magistracies. Who were held by men who served not to fulfill pecuniary ambitions, but men who had the ambition to serve the public, the people, and the state. We saw this separation of powers, the consuls, and the praetors who had the imperium, who had the authority to command armies, and to execute the laws. And the exercise of imperium gave them the authority to execute the soldiers under their command, or to execute people within the city of Rome, execute without trial. At a later point, this power was taken away from the imperium in that they could not execute within the city of Rome or within 1 mile of the city without trial. We saw this separation of powers. The questors, who had supervision over the issuance of the payments to soldiers, and who also had supervision over the public treasury, the aerarium in Rome, always, however, under the control of the Senate. The Senate had the power over the purse, complete power over the purse. The consuls could issue their vouchers in the field, the Senate, before those vouchers could be paid, the Senate had to approve the payments. We saw these checks and balances, one consul being able to veto the acts of the other consul, one tribune being able to veto the acts of the other tribune, or tribunes, or consuls, or other higher magistrates, with the exception of the dictator. We saw the various assemblies, the various commissions. And we have seen that their actions could be vetoed by the Senate. So here in the Roman Republic, from its earliest days, through the early Republic and the Middle Republic, certainly, the Senate was supreme, and its power over the purse was supreme. Little wonder that the average Roman was inspired as he looked back upon the examples of the statesmen and generals of earlier times, inspired to give of his best, inspired to serve. Little wonder that this Roman people acquired control over the surrounding tribes and stretched its supremacy from the Gallic north throughout the entire Italian peninsula. And little wonder that this small fledgling city that was founded on the River Tiber came to be the greatest city of antiquity and to rule over the greatest empire of antiquity. Mr. President, I yield the floor.
Senator from West Virginia yields the floor. Who seeks recognition?